Today on All Across Oregon, food, fish, and more food. We start our day at a very popular bakery in East Medford. From there, we take a drive to Trail, and we show you a hidden gem inside of a market and gas station. Then, we go behind the scenes of a fish hatchery. Oh, and wait till you see this waterfall. Let's get started. Here we go. This episode of All Across Oregon is made possible in part by Diamond Medical Maintenance, a premier custom-built medical facility cleaning company catering exclusively to the medical community in Southern Oregon, the Klamath Basin, and Roseburg for 27 years. John A. Warakoy, CPA, LLC, premier tax professional and business profit builder, helping self-employed business owners achieve success with essential finance activities. And Southern Oregon Jewelry, fine jewelry specialist, family owned and operated, offering custom jewelry work and repairs, and GIA certified for grading diamonds, home of the exclusive $2 per point up to 5-point diamond program. When it comes to baking, it's said that it's all about a balancing act between time, temperature, and ingredients. That's the art of baking. Here at the Great Harvest Bakery, that's exactly what they're doing, a beautiful balancing act. I want you to meet my friends, Lisa and Dan Allen, hands-on owners and talented bakers.
Welcome.
Thank you, nice to be here. This is I love this place.
Thank you.
And I guess you said I'm here right in time to grind some flour.
Yes, we're gonna
mill.
We're gonna mill, we mill every day.
Can you show me the mill room?
You bet, let's go look.
Okay, I'll follow you.
So we start the mill, and then, you know, once it gets going, then we just dump the milling
wheat. So this is wheat right here.
Yeah.
Let me show the camera how your bread starts.
Great. Right,
so you're going to turn the mill on now.
Dan's making our cinnamon chip bread, one of our most popular breads.
All right, we're just making balls?
Look at this, buddy.
Not bad. What? We're gonna have to hire him. Look at that, double kneading right there. All right, and then.
That? You wanna see me juggle it now?
What?
No.
I can't juggle.
No, just kidding.
Take your ball and get that seam.
We just want to leave it a seam in there.
You get a little
right
seam
there.
So that you can kind of roll it up.
Yep.
And make it like a little longer than that.
Yep. Like that?
Yeah, not bad. Maybe not like a baguette, but.
Oh, we don't want a baguette.
Maybe like a little bit of a fat cigar.
Get that back there.
Perfect.
You guys eat your own food all day long? Is it all day? I don't know how long ago it was, but you told me you got sick.
Yes, so I'm recovering from breast cancer, and during that time I didn't get here at 4 a.m.
No, but your staff did.
My staff stood by me, and we didn't have to close, you know, due to that. I was out for a good year.
Really?
Yeah, so while I was going through, you know, treatment and getting well again, raising our three children, I think that was probably hard for me to let everybody run things, but they did such a great job, and I realized that I can pull back a little bit, you know, or a lot. And that was a real blessing,
It says a lot about you two to have your staff step up like that. When Lisa and Dan mentioned the trials they went through, the chemo, it just struck a chord with me. I know what it takes to run a business with a sick spouse. Most everybody knows my wife. We almost lost her a couple of years ago again, and she had to go through the chemo, and that was a rough time. So a lot of hard work goes into keeping our business run, and they did it. This is the what is the word I'm looking for? It's like the almost like the epitome of it, the show. I mean, this is
nice.
What you guys have done and who you are and what you've accomplished together. And
Thank
there's
you.
Nothing easy about this, is there? There's nothing easy about it. stress level when you were sick, really great job. And now I'm watching you and I can see what I did wrong on the loaves. You really gave it a good crease in the middle, and then you left it there. Thank you for letting me roll some bread. And not only just bread, I rolled cinnamon bread. This is my kind of oven right here. So which one is this?
That's the pumpkin.
Oh yeah. Oh, so moist, so good. This is not gluten-free.
Gluten-free and dairy-free.
And dairy-free.
Yes.
And it has this moisture.
Yep.
Oh, I need a hug. There's so much stuff happening in this bakery right now that my mind is blown. But if I was gluten-free and dairy-free, I'm okay to come into Great Harvest.
Right, as long as you're not celiac. Okay. And you can, you know, afford to have wheat in the air, because as you saw from the mill, you know, there's wheat in the air. But yeah, we have you covered. We make a gluten-free product every day of the week. And on Mondays, we make a bread that is made without dairy and without gluten.
Is that the pumpkin one?
Pumpkin.
And banana?
And we alternate it between pumpkin and banana.
Do you two love working together?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's been a challenge, you know, being in business with your spouses at times, but 22 years now,
22 years.
Has it been 22 years?
Yeah.
We have that in common. 22 years, my wife and I, since we started.
Wow, since you started in Vinny's, huh?
Yeah. You two are amazing, and I am so grateful that you have me here visiting. This has been a real treat.
Thank you.
Thank you for your talent.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Now that we got breakfast and some amazing pastries and some coffee, we start our drive out Highway 62 to the small town of Trail, Oregon, just north of Shady Cove. And we're gonna show you why it's a must stop. I can't wait to introduce you to yet another family-run business, and wait till you see the food that comes out of this gas station and market. This is Alberto and Daytona Gutierrez, and they are part of this dedicated, hardworking family that does a lot more than you think. I think I smelled it when I walked in before I walked in the door.
Yeah.
We're making corn tortillas?
We're gonna make corn tortillas.
How many of these you guys make a day?
On a busy day, at least 100.
100?
Yeah.
Dang, son, that's why you got these guns. Look at this. I'm gonna start pressing tortillas. So what's in this corn mixture? Is it we're talking corn flour and water?
Corn flour and water.
That's it?
That's it.
No spices, no nothing?
No spices, no nothing. It's a tortilla masa that my mom, who's been working here who started the kitchen. We bought the store in 2004, and about 5 or 6 years later, we started the kitchen. This used to be an office. We converted it into a kitchen to give people a more authentic Mexican experience. My mom, she started looking around. A friend of hers that used to work with us, her name's Raquel, her and my mom started doing working on the recipes, just working on them, just kind of perfecting them. And what we have here now is a labor of both of their work.
This place is amazing, and you would never guess this was in the back of your market.
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize it. We've actually have a lot of people that come in a lot and didn't realize until actually during the pandemic, when all the restaurants closed down, they were looking for somewhere to eat, and they finally realized that we cook food.
Oh man, can I try pressing a flour tortilla?
Go ahead.
I can try one? Okay. So I'm gonna take this. I watched you. So I saw you put that there, take that separate. I washed my hands already. Okay, am I gonna go ahead and make a ball?
Yep.
Okay, just make a ball, that's it.
Yep.
So maybe one ounce ball or something like that? Right in the middle. And then you went like that. Then you pushed it down with your hand. Then you went like that. And then one time. Whoops. So how many do you think I need to do to get those?
About 100 a day.
About 100 a day? For how long?
I'd say...
Oh, look at this. I made a stinking tortilla, man. I pressed my own corn tortilla.
So you lay your hand flat. Yep.
I didn't see how you got that off. It's like this? No. That's all right. Don't eat this one. Oh my gosh, what a mess. Oh my gosh. What'd I do? No. No, don't see me. Don't see me. It could have been worse. I'm just a rookie. I think I put it down the wrong way is what happened. But he didn't tell me what I did wrong. They're keeping their family secret. Well, I'm gonna let it go. That's mine.
Take the tortilla, lay it halfway on your hand, and just let the grill. It's gonna stick to the grill when it's raw, and you let the grill take it off, and just kind of peel your hand under away from it.
Well, I wanted to make mine different anyway. You guys, all yours looks the same.
They look the same, yeah.
Yeah, not mine. Like if someone, who did? Oh, Vinny did that one. You use this?
Yep.
Like this?
Yep. My mom flips them by hand. Doesn't use that. She's
old school.
She's got the technique down. Sometimes I have to.
What's this?
That is our carne asada. A lot of people love our carne asada. Our main goal is to give a good food that is fast. We like to make burritos ahead of time for breakfast burritos. In the morning, people stop by before work or when they're going to the lake or go fishing. A lot of guys like to go fishing in the morning. They'll stop by, grab a quick burrito, and head up to the river and start fishing.
All right, so what are you doing? Carne asada tacos?
Carne asada tacos.
Okay, and this is just regular on the menu, right? Nobody has
regular,
to think of anything
no.
special. I feel like I gotta turn my hat around. I feel like we're getting ready to do work right here.
Yeah.
Hey guys, check this out. Look at this over here. They're gonna top them now. I think I'm gonna eat my tortilla. Let me see. Oh yeah, I did good.
You did good?
I did good.
And this is the enchiladas that she prepped. They're all ready to go now.
Oh, that's what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a carne asada burrito?
Yeah. And all our salsas here that we make ourselves, they're homemade.
And tell me the name of the town again your family's from.
They're from the state of Guerrero.
Can you please, you need to roll your R's, okay?
Guerrero.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh, we got a 14-pound burrito. I'm like a kid in a candy shop right now. This is like, I'm surrounded by tacos and burritos and enchiladas and salsas. Holy mackerel, okay.
We're also gonna make you a quesadilla.
What a gem of a spot. What a great family. It's literally worth the drive just for the tacos. Now that we had a great lunch, we're gonna continue a few more miles north to the Fish Hatchery. And man, what a fun way to get an education and see these beauties up close. We even got some hands-on experience. Check these guys and gals out. Meet the man in charge, David Peace. Take us to the little fishies.
Will do, let's go.
So it all starts inside.
Well, it's kind of hard to explain because we spawn the fish down there. So when does it really start? When we take the eggs or from down here? But we're gonna go where the eggs are right now.
So this is our hatch house. This is where the babies come. Each one of these are called Heath incubator trays. So each one of these trays will hold 5,000 eggs. And as they develop, we go through and do what's called a shock and a pick. And it's not electricity shock. It's we take the trays out and we rattle them, we'll pour them through a machine. And what that does is if the egg is not fertilized, the embryo will pop and it turns the egg white. And then we go through and pick out the bad eggs, re-inventory them back into the tray to where there's 5,000 in each one of these trays.
Wow.
So these are summer steelhead that we spawned a while back.
Whoa, oh, there's some white ones. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, so those are the white ones that they weren't fertilized, so they're the ones that die. These are just starting to hatch. If you look real close, you can kind of see
the
different
spot.
Color. The black spots are their eyes.
Oh,
so if we're real careful
goodness.
Here, you can kind of see those eyes?
Since their eyes. Okay, and it's cold in here. I mean, so what happens in the summertime? Is this air conditioning all the time?
No, this is just cold because of all the water.
Okay.
Our water's running about 45 degrees right now, so that just keeps things nice and cool in here. Even in the summer when it's 100 plus degrees, you come in here and it's pretty nice.
It's still like this.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it was cold in there.
I do have some fish that are starting to hatch, so now we call them fry.
Fry?
Yeah, so when they're eggs, when they're hatched, but still have their yolk, they're fry. And then once we put them in the ponds, that yolk is absorbed. Those are now fish.
Yep.
So you can see how much these are swimming around a little bit more.
Uh-huh. And how long they stay in here?
It's all temperature dependent.
Okay.
We heat the water, they develop faster. We cool the water, their development slows down.
That's crazy. I didn't realize so much was involved. I thought you throw the eggs in the water, they hatch, you throw them in the water, in the river.
It was only that easy, right?
Wow, I had no ideas.
Once they, what we call button up, they absorb that yolk, there's just a very thin line down their belly. That's when we'll either put them in these starter troughs,
mm-hmm.
or they'll go directly outside. Some of our takes are, or our groups are over 2 million fish. They won't all fit in here, so we have to put them directly outside.
Okay, so all these numbers, 5,000, 5,000, 5,000, 2 million. So if somebody was to say, well, do you have a number that you produce fish a year? Is there a number, like a whole number?
Can't give you the exact number because it's constantly changing, but it's over 5 million fish in a year.
5 million fish, okay, that's incredible.
So these are rainbow trout, and there's about 40,000 fish, 40 to 50,000 fish in each one of these troughs. You can see here we have some food, but these guys have been eating pretty good. See, they're coming up and whacking it.
Look at that. So these are rainbow trout. So it's not just salmon here. It's all kinds of fish.
Yeah, we raise rainbow, summer steelhead, winter steelhead, spring chinook, fall chinook, and coho.
Wow.
Once they're in here and we get about 150 pounds in each one of these troughs, that's when they get moved outside.
Okay.
So we'll set up a pipe. We take and the pipe hooks up to this valve right here.
Yes.
And then we just run a hose out the door to whatever pond we want. Pull the gate, pull the screen, out they go.
That's it.
Best thing is not to handle fish, right?
Okay.
So we're doing what we call water-to-water transfer. They're in the water, they stay in the water, and they go to the water.
And this is that water?
Yep.
This is all natural water?
All Rogue River water.
All Rogue River water, okay.
And it's just like a big water slide for fish, you know? So we do have some coho in here. These were raised in what we call incubator jars, which are those right there.
Uh-huh.
I don't have any with just eggs in them right now. These have all hatched, and when they hatch, they do what they call swim up. So they swim up to the top of the water there, and then they plunge into this right here. So these are baby coho. Kind of hard to see, but these still have kind of a yolk on them.
Uh-huh.
And so they're not quite buttoned up.
Oh, I see the eggs in there with the eyes.
Yep.
Back in there, huh? Oh, and that one's coming together right there. He's got a body through an egg.
Yep, and that's what the yolk sac is.
Okay.
That's where they get all their nutrition.
And then they're up here, and then they know to come up.
Yep, they just
say we're out.
They come swim up, and out they go.
Now we're heading to see the next process from the hose out to a pond.
Yep. So we call it ponding them outside or moving them outside. So we'll run the hose using gravity. It's just gonna flow naturally downhill, and then they'll end up in one of these ponds over here. These are spring chinook that were freshly ponded. So there's approximately 500,000 in this pond. Like I said, as they get bigger, they're gonna need more space. So they're gonna go into another pond. So then they'll go to their final destination pond after that. And it depends on the species. The steelhead, they'll go out in April, late April, early May, constantly moving fish.
So you have a release coming up in a month then?
Yeah, on our summer steelhead smolts. And those guys will be, they'll be 6 to 8 inches long. The goal there is to let them go and down to the ocean.
I was curious if you knew like an average for them to get here to the coast.
Probably about a week and a half to 2 weeks.
Really? That's fast.
Yeah, the ones we're gonna look at are ones that we call bigs. We do some larger rainbow, kind of trophies, or there's several different names for them.
Okay.
Those are right over here.
Oh, that's a lot of fish. Yeah. So those are about 10 inches.
These guys are probably more around the 12 to 14 inch range.
So it's not long until they get to go do their thing then.
Yep, these, we took a load of these out this morning. They were headed to Upper and Lower Empire Lakes down on the coast. And we do what we call holding the fish, which means we don't feed them for at least 2 days before we haul them. Because if you load them up with a full belly, they just they stress real easily. So we let them get all that stress out before we put them on the truck. And bonus is when they come off the truck, they're hungry, they're ready to go.
Well, that's how I started today.
Yeah.
So I have no stress right now, but I'm hungry.
There you go. So. Maybe a little fish sandwich.
Yeah, maybe a little fish sandwich. And so what are these big ones?
So these are where we...
That's where they come in?
Yeah. So these are what we call our holding ponds, adult holding ponds. So the fish, we can go over there too. And the fish come up the river and there's an approach channel. And then they come up the fish ladder into our collection pond. And from the collection pond, we sort them out. And we'll see some tubes where we throw the fish down. So they'll decide, okay, is that one brood? One that will spawn, it gets thrown here. Is it excess? It'll go thrown in another one.
Come on, let's see where it actually really begins.
So this is what I call the approach channel. The fish will start off, you know, 157 miles downstream at the ocean, and they'll work their way up, dodging predators, fishermen, trying to get here to spawn. And so they come into this approach channel, and there's a big hole in the concrete you can kind of see.
Yep, I see it.
So the fish will swim in that hole, and then they'll work their way on up the ladder and then jump into our collection pond. And then we'll clean that out weekly. And the fish ladder's built so the fish has a place to rest. They don't have to work hard. They'll make a jump. There's all these back eddies. You know, they just kind of hang out. Oh, I'm gonna go to the next one, and up they go. And then the final jump will be over there into the collection pond.
Which is right there?
Yeah.
Look. I don't know if he just got up or he's trying to get up or what.
And if you look up there, you can see there's a decent number of fish in the collection pond. It's not full by any means, but there's a few of them in there. So we'll get to play with some fish here in a little bit.
And then they're just gonna hang out there for now until it's time.
Yep.
That's what you were talking about, the collect.
Yes.
You have a lot of responsibility.
Yeah.
Man, good for you. I think people need to know how hard people like you work behind the scenes.
It's definitely challenging at times. Other times, you know, it's great. You know, we're down here having a good time playing with fish, you know, making fish.
5 million babies a year.
Hey, you know.
Jeez.
But yeah, there's a lot behind the scenes that, you know, people don't know. So right now he's determining whether it's a male or a female. And then he'll call it out. We have somebody recording. But if you want to grab one.
Yeah. Unmarked buck.
Okay.
Probably would not be able to do that if he was not.
No, he would be kicking your butt right now. So this is a female.
This one?
Yep. So if you hold her up, got kind of a bigger belly and a rounded face.
Okay.
So that tells it's a female. This is a buck. See how the nose is pointed on it?
Yes.
And then a skinnier belly.
Oh. Yes.
He's got that skinny belly. This just so happens to be a wild fish. So that this fin is there. So that means that we didn't clip it off as a baby. These, that fin is gone. We clipped that off when it was
just a baby. So these have already gone and come back?
Yeah. This has been in the ocean 2-3 years and they're coming back to spawn.
Wow, so this guy was raised here.
Yep.
He was born and raised here, went to the ocean, and now he's back.
So you'll see they kind of lay there.
Yes.
But then here in a little bit, we're gonna be getting wet because they're gonna come back to life that quick. Okay.
That was so cool, and it was fun, and it smelled. Then there's Jessie Brownlee. She's the natural resource manager, and she tells us about other local attractions to see in the area. And she told us that Mill Creek Falls was a must-see. Like I said, I was just driving up here, and I was visiting the hatchery, which is what we're doing right now, and I wanted to go take a nice little day trip.
We got some great bird watching this time of year. We just saw an eagle that went by over there. We've got all sorts of hiking, backpacking, camping, fishing, boating, all sorts of like swimming, anything, pretty much anything you want to do with your family out here in the great outdoors, you can do that. We've got about 30 miles of trail that ring the lake, designated as part of the National Trail System in 1981, so that's a pretty cool thing.
And waterfalls.
But if you go up to Prospect, there's three waterfalls in walking distance of each other. You got Pearsony Waterfalls, Bar Creek and Mill Creek. And then there's a pretty cool waterfall where the road goes under Mill Creek Drive also.
Mill Creek, that's one where you hike in a little bit and then you're eye level with the fall, but the fall's way down.
Yeah, so it's across
yes,
the gorge. Yep.
That's where we're going next.
Yeah, pretty cool.
We're gonna go see Mill Creek Falls and we're gonna eat tacos and we're gonna eat burritos.
Yeah.
We're gonna eat like crazy.
You gonna eat Maria's tacos?
Did you know we stopped there, Maria's tacos?
Oh man, her tacos are the best. Yes.
What a great day. Great people, hardworking, devoted families, beautiful landscape. If you haven't taken the time to see the beauty in this area, make this a day trip. Get some pastries and coffee from Great Harvest. Go to the trail market and get some tacos and burritos. Check out the fish at the Fish Hatchery. And man, don't miss Mill Creek Falls. We'll see you next time as we go all across Oregon.
This episode of All Across Oregon is made possible in part by Diamond Medical Maintenance, a premier custom-built medical facility cleaning company catering exclusively to the medical community in Southern Oregon, the Klamath Basin, and Roseburg for 27 years. John A. Warakoy, CPA, LLC, premier tax professional and business profit builder, helping self-employed business owners achieve success with essential finance activities. And Southern Oregon Jewelry, fine jewelry specialist, family owned and operated, offering custom jewelry work and repairs, and GIA certified for grading diamonds, home of the exclusive $2 per point up to 5-point diamond program.